We'll now move to our next session. Riaz Komu's work as an artist, sculptor, curator, art administrator shows a remarkable continuity of artistic and political engagement with the times. He's a passing witness, a traveler who bears witness. Please welcome Riaz Komu, who is a multimedia artist and activist working towards reviving art education and developing art infrastructure in India. His works have been exhibited extensively in India and abroad. He was one of the two artists from India chosen by Robert Storr for the 52nd Venice Biennale. He co-founded the Kochi Muzires Biennale in 2012 and initiated segments such as Children's Biennale, Students' Biennale, and Artist Cinema. He is currently working as Director of Programs for the Kochi Biennale Foundation and developing projects focusing on art education in India. He has been presented with numerous awards in recognition of his work, including Maharashtra State Art Prize and Bombay Art Society Award. In October 2015, Art Review ranked Riaz Komu and Bose Krishnamachari among the 100 most influential people in the art world. Please join me in extending to him a very, very warm welcome. He will be in conversation with Gayatri Sinha. Gayatri Sinha is a critic, editor, and curator who works in the domains of gender, lens-based art, and cultural politics. She has edited Art and Visual Culture in India in 1857 to 2007, Woman, Goddess, and Expressions and Evocations, Contemporary Indian Women Artists of India, amongst others. She has written monographs on the artists Krishan Khanna and Himmat Shah. As a curator, she has worked with the National Gallery of Modern Art, the National Museum, the Newark Museum, and the Photography Forum Frankfurt, amongst several others. Since 2011, she directly supports knowledge in the arts in institutional and non-institutional spaces through her initiative, Critical Collective. Please join me in welcoming her.
Welcome to our audience, and it's my privilege to be able to speak today to Riaz Komu. He's already been introduced and is extremely well known in the art world as a great initiator of projects. I think more than just the project space which we look at Kochi, it is the initiative in terms of a certain cultural politics, a certain cultural reimagining of histories, and a certain kind of political location of what can be known as a wider kind of a cultural frame for which Riaz Komu has earned so much distinction. We thought that we would structure the talk around his practice, his own art practice as an artist, but also then weave it into the movement, into the Kochi Biennial, of which, as you know, he's one of the founder directors. So perhaps we can start, Riaz, by talking about Bombay. You come to Bombay in 1992. This is a momentous moment in India where globalization has sort of entered the fabric, the social fabric. This is also when Advani's Rath Yatra is rolling, and the city of Mumbai undergoes tremendous change. What was it that brought you there, and you also then shift to the practice of art and the study of art, though you initially went perhaps to learn textile design? Why didn't you tell us about this?
See, maybe before I come into the Bombay context, I think I feel it's important to speak a little bit about my personal background. I was very fortunate because I was born into a very, very active family. My father's brothers were living around, and I have seven brothers and two sisters. So I was actually grew up in a very protected atmosphere. I think I always feel that it has given me a lot of strength to kind of understand many layers of life. And my father was had a very strong tendency, to engage always with the society.
He was quite. You said somewhere that everybody in the village would come to your father for something or the other because he was so engaged.
Yeah, he was in that sense. I mean, he was one of the socialists I have encountered from early years of my life. Many reasons he was. Actively interested, involved in politics. Then he had a matchbox factory where more than 150 people working. He was also the matchbox factory association president in Kerala. So his involvement not only with the laborers but also with the trade unionism in Kerala. And he was an active member in the Toddy Tappers Association, though he's never consumed a drop of alcohol in his life. So it's interesting to kind of grow up in a very politically engaged life, and he's taught us many things. I mean, he always some of the best things he's taught us about, about religion. Like, I mean, he always used to say, like, it's one of the most personal thing which you should have, and once you are in a social space, the religion is not your, point of conversation at all. I mean, you have to live a very strong political life. So I think the base, I would say that very interesting to kind of, then coming to Bombay with, I still remember writing in my dissertation that my
Did you come alone? Did you come with any, because Kerala students sometimes, they move.
I came along with one of my other friend called Krishna Kumar, I mean, who became a computer engineer. So we both decided, we were studying pre-degree together. So we decided to come together. I think, I still remember, my father, I wrote a line in my dissertation, my father gave me an emotional ticket to travel to Bombay. Because it was difficult for him to kind of me going as a youngest son. But he was very liberal in his approach. He thought, let him pursue textile design, because I was very much interested in textile design that time. And I came to Bombay because JJ had textile design. But things change, I always feel that, it's fate to be in Bombay, because many things which follows has a very great relationship to that travel which I the train which I took, the Jayanti Janada, took to Bombay, because not only in the area of, my work, also understanding Kerala's cultural space much more better, because I started developing an aerial view.
What was the art ground of Bombay like? Was it hospitable to people coming from other cultures? Was it sensitized to perhaps these kinds of, variations or other kinds of orientations towards the big metropolis? What was its how did it receive?
See, my first reaction to Bombay was like, almost like I fell in love with the city, and because of the cosmopolitan nature of the city, and the best thing which I learned from Bombay, especially moving from Kerala, the people are very argumentative about everything, but Bombay, I felt that they're very unconditional about everything. So that was one of the biggest change. I mean, many of my later communications with my father, I used to speak about the social space in Bombay. I used to speak about railway stations. I used to speak about the struggle of the people. Used to write letters to him about the slums in Bombay. So it was very interesting. I wanted to kind of keep him in the loop, what he was doing there. Getting into that kind of a space. So Bombay was for me one of the biggest universities. Many things, which not only the institution. The moment you step out of the college, the things which you learn was knowledge in abundance.
You arrived at an art language which was very interesting. Your paintings show the face filling the frame almost flush. So it compels a very intimate look, close-up look at whoever the subject is, which is usually a subject from the working class. That is what we've come to expect from a lot of the paintings. And the sculpture tends to be much more exhaustive, enormous. I mean, we've seen these kinds of paintings of civilizational quality from, say, Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh. This is the quality you bring to your sculpture. And this is unusual, because in India there was no paradigm for this. There was no paradigm for a sculpture. For instance, let's take up, say, we're talking about in the context of your father. Let's discuss My Father's Balcony, which you make in 2005. And you said your father never had a balcony, but the view from the balcony is one of a markedly well-integrated space of different kinds of faiths. Do you want to speak a little about that? How did you arrive at this vision quite in a very, it's as if you've arrived at it, it's a very complete vision.
Yeah. So I think the 92 impact is very strong, because what the 92 impact is about, I mean, in arguing for a secular space. You know, you always thought that, I mean, you've come from a background which is very secular, very multicultural, you know, a place that where coexistence was like, I mean, some, one of the key things. So the first exhibition which I did, which was actually one of the largest exhibition I did in my career, called Faith Accompli, which was in Delhi, Lalitakala Academy.
Yeah, space. I remember that show.
So I did that exhibition, which actually spoke about the layers of religion which you have actually gone through, and it was almost my critique against the kind of the way that religion has been used also to kind of manipulate many things, because it's all started with that, you know, the first learnings of art with in a 92 background. So after doing the Delhi show, I took the show back to Bombay. So I actually added another layer to that, because I realized I need to say a little bit more of an assertive story about my own personal upbringing. So I created this installation which had almost like a feel of a Noah's Ark, but he could climb up. And the reason it was called My Father's Balcony, because I wanted to kind of bring in the landscape of Kerala, and you're cutting across and seeing maybe like, I mean, crossing what you've already seen, and also addressing the world like, I mean, there is much beyond that. And I think Kerala for me, I mean, because these are the times like I started getting a strong interest in studying Kerala's cultural history. Mm. If you look at the involvement of a person like K.N. Panikkar as one of the strongest historians like Kerala has ever produced, his resistance against the issues which was happening in terms of like politicizing religion, also manipulating archaeology, which had a kind of a very interest in me. So I also wanted to kind of bring those things in his work, in that particular work. So K.N. Panikkar was somebody who asserted, mainly at that point of time, that most of the manipulations happens because you don't take a scientific evidence and proof to talk to people in clarity. So that was one of the biggest reason, the issue which happened in the Babri Masjid demolition. So in Kerala's context, I mean, if you really look at some of the things was emerging from the Kerala's land itself, looking at the Pattanam excavation site, it became an interesting discourse in Kerala, because he was somebody who was, you know, one way or the other, like overseeing that, and he kept the argument very alive. And he said, Muziris is not this Muziris. Let's not say that it's Muziris. Let's wait and let's excavate. And KCHR followed it. I mean, you know, P.J. Cherian followed that kind of a thing. So these all things, like, I mean, you know, was becoming as a kind of a background. I always carried those kind of learnings to talk about a secular side, because Muziris deals with that kind of a secular opening.
Yeah, Panikkar has this interesting suggestion about what constitutes the cultural space, that it is separate from religion, and this is where we, in a certain sense, have failed. Even in Marxist historiography, there's a certain failure, because cultural memory tends to dissipate and it's not followed. So the nation in its excavations, or its nation in building its history, has looked at politics, it's looked at economics, but it doesn't look at culture as a valid space. I want to come to you about this. I think this question of cultural memory through archaeology will come back again and again. But what about the figure of Gandhi? I hope many of you who are coming in have seen the work by Riaz, which has got those 6 paintings. And there is his interpretation of many of the Gandhi key words of certain resistance. Panikkar says that there is a direct line in the making of a secular culture in India from Gandhi to Kumaraswamy to Tagore. That's the line that he draws. You showed this work in JNU, and then you showed it in Kashi Gallery.
Yeah.
And somebody writing on you made a very interesting observation. Kashi is now a BJP stronghold. But Kashi is also the most ancient Indian city. And Kashi in Kerala and Gandhi make an interesting sort of a position. I wanted you to perhaps talk about this, this location.
See, when it was shown in Delhi, the whole context was different. But again, there was an assertion on the importance and relevance of Gandhi, bringing back him into the argument. But in Kochi, my experience of living in Kochi since last, you know, doing the project there, the biennial, I used to spend a lot of time with the people, the community there. And it's almost like the residue of a, you know, a trade history of, I mean, the glorious past of Kochi. So, and at the same time that in the last, you know, one or two years that we've been hearing stories of, you know, the many layers. So I wanted to readdress Gandhi and, you know, like maybe, you know, make him a little bit more, you know, again using the term like more argumentative in the context of now. And I wanted to make a Gandhi who's like fearless and, you know, who represents fearlessness and who also represents the idea of, you know, resistance. So all those, the layers, I mean, the five works, which actually talks about, I mean, Gandhian ideals, but the interpretation in the current context. And why I like the idea of Kashi, it was also because I had gone, you know, I was in Varanasi at the time of the Lok Sabha election last year for, you know, 10 days. I was doing many, also doing research and, you know, talking to people. And I've seen three different political processions. So I felt that, you know, it was very interesting to kind of, even sitting in Kochi itself, that you could have an ideal site, because Kashi has, gallery also has a very romantic history. This Anoop, who's a very radical young boy who traveled to Himalayas, and he met an American girl there, and they came back, actually started this Kashi Art Gallery. So there's that art became a kind of a part of the youngster's life in Kochi in recent times, because of the Kashi was a space where many people used to meet for, you know, almost like the Varanasi Adda, which you talk about. So Kashi had that, I mean, Kashi Art Cafe. Mm. I mean, it became like, I mean, one of the biggest addas in, you know, Fort Kochi Mattampally.
Right.
So it's a point of, it's a space where many people use for discussion. So, I felt it was very contextual to show there.
Yeah. It's also in through the work, how do you revitalize or re-envision or perhaps re-understand Gandhi in our own times? That's important. But let's come to this question of memory. There is the site of archaeology, of which Muziris, you can speak to us a little bit about how the biennial becomes also Kochi Muziris. That's one area. But it's also your own location, Riaz, whereas there is the site of the past as the imaginary, Babylon. I was looking at the title of the work, which is one of your most important works.
Watching the Other World,
Spirits from the Garden of Babylon. Today, how do you revisit Babylon? Look at what's happening in Syria. Look at those sites of Iraq and Syria, the complete bombardment of artworks. And do you feel that even in the 10 years or so when you made the work, there has been a sort of a relocating of the historicity, the cultural value, etc., attached to these sites? I wanted to ask you about this.
See, many of the subjects which I have dealt in my practice has like progressed from, I would say, not from, sometimes like not from Kerala, it's progressed from my Bombay experiences. Mm. So the global politics was always an interesting aspect, and I started focusing on displacement as an issue, and where it comes to, but the heads are skulls. Mm. They are, you know, that doesn't represent, like, I mean, you know, the similar tribal art forms which was used for positive reasons. This represents the kind of, you know, the agony and, you know, the pain of the people. So I kept that kind of a way of thinking. Most of my works were about the dead.
Yeah, it is.
You know,
yeah,
so there was always the representation of the dead into, you know, the context of sculpting especially. But painting always carried a certain kind of a hope with mainly the portraits of the anonymous people. So I would say that, I mean, you know, it's a, because I always think about my art practice as an archiving of a time, you know, so it's not just making just art. So I'm trying to kind of archive my work as I progress.
Well, that's very interesting. Actually, I should tell you, when I was teaching in Bhavdaji Land, and one of the students lives in Borivali, near where your studio is. So she talked about your practice, and she said he has a very ethical practice because he wants to make a portrait of any person over there. It could be any kind of labor. He takes permission, and then the photograph is sort of approved, and then the portrait takes place. So it's a kind of an archiving, and it's a kind of a documentation. So as you're suggesting that the field of the painting is vital, located in the present, and perhaps anonymous, but these are people who are very much within the working class, whereas the sculptures are like an excavation, perhaps even of the field of imagination. You've said somewhere that my studio is like it's like a graveyard of the moment of our times, and that is partly because you do refer a lot to the Kabristan, coffins, skulls. Your work on Karachi, for instance. You did two series of photographs in Karachi, both of them about the Kabristan. Where was that coming from, and what was it that you wanted to hold through this work?
Yeah, I think thanks to Khoj, I mean, I was given a residency program for a month in Karachi in 2004. And usually your first thinking is like you are in an enemy state. But when you start indulging with the people, seeing the hospitality, the way you are traveling around, I mean, I was never, because identified as an outsider, because I always, whenever I used to walk with the foreigners there, they will ask like, I mean, isko leke kahan ja raha hai, you know, like it's I was always there. But these are the things like which comes back to you, like about, you know, the idea of separating, you know, the sameness, you know, from you, you know, that, so. But I was a little confused when I reached at Karachi, what will I work on, because I always hear people working on, partition was one of the major subjects. But I didn't want to touch upon that, because personally I've not experienced, but I've, you know, you have read through, that is something happens when you, you know, as a geographically, when you're, you know, in a place like Kerala. But what attracted me was like, I mean, my encounters with people. I touched upon one image before I went to this graveyard's visit. I saw a carpenter's tool, which exactly looked like, you know, when you lift it up, it had a cross, you know, so, and that image was one of the first thing which struck me there, and I, in fact, produced sculptures around that. So, I was...
What does it mean to you? Because even in Faith Accompli, you had used the cross within those automotive painted works.
Yeah, this is happened actually after the Iraq, Karachi trip. But I was one day I was moving around with a Chinese photographer, and I just saw this in the middle of the Karachi city, a Christian cemetery, massive land, and it's a post Second World War Christian cemetery, beautiful. I mean, in one way or the other, I mean, it's kept, it's fully. You know, dilapidated, but the whole thing, like, I mean, for my kind of way I respond to these kind of sites, I felt like, oh, wow, I mean, so I started documenting that. Then we went out, we went to Tatta, Makli area, 100 kilometers from Karachi. That's where I encountered, like, the past, almost, you know, because there's a glorious past in the graveyard. I mean, it's full of decorative tombstones, and it's mainly, I spoke to people like, I mean, these were the people, the Sufis lived in those region, you know, the Rajas, you know, like, I mean, it's a princely families, and even the ordinary people. So I started documenting them, like, I mean, so just with the kind of an affection towards a kind of a glorious past. I mean, so I took this as one context, and the and the Christian missionary images was almost like a juxtaposition with that, because it was also post Second World War, and it didn't have any kind of decor on this. Mm. It was very interesting to kind of see. So for me, the Karachi trip was almost to encounter almost like a glorious past of in one level.
So it's very interesting. This is also reworking of certain kinds of histories. There's the work, we had shown this together, which you had made of, it was a prototype, small prototype, which you had, he had shown it in Iran, Azad Art Gallery, and you had a big exhibition over there, forgetting the name of the,
but Blood you, Brothers.
Yeah, Blood, not only Blood Brothers, this was the one of the extraction of oil.
Yeah,
now this was
the alembic, the safe to light.
Safe to light. I found this very interesting because I saw an exhibition in Venice,
yeah,
which was about how the hermetic sciences or hermetic knowledge, as it was sort of developing in the Arab countries in the pre-enlightenment era, then becomes subsumed into European knowledge. And Arab, I mean, this is something Edward Said would have also talked about, how Arab knowledge is in a way suppressed. This, it really ties in with where we are today. If whether it's Marxism or Marxist historiography or political systems, we seem to be entering or have already entered a post-European kind of phase of knowledge systems. Your work addresses this, that what about, and then you go and place this work in Iran. Would you like to talk about
that? Yeah, I think these are some of the learnings also, like when I was talking about Ken Panikkar, because that's what also Muzuris teaches you. Because before the, you know, we talk about the pre-enlightenment, the Muzuris was actually discovered, and if you take Salman Rushdie's reference to Kochi. So there's a...
What is Salman Rushdie's reference?
No, he,
just
in,
for the benefit.
In Moore's Last Sigh, I mean, there is a remark that, I mean, you know, when people talk about the age of discovery, you know, I'm encountering the people who are already discovered. So it's a, you know, that's, I mean, when you talked about, there are many connections, like if you, in relation with proselytization of, you know, the Kerala community, in relation with Vasco da Gama also, he thought that, I mean, he's coming to spread Christianity, but Christianity was always there, you know, before even Rome was built. So there's a kind of a interesting site which you're already in. Mm. This is also a region which had trade relations with the Chinese, the Persians, and, you know, like many layers of people. So for me, you know, many of the ideals which you talk like, I mean, which is European, doesn't go into my head. Mm. Because you always believed in a certain system, but, I mean, you know,
so
you were always discovered. So that is something which I keep it as an energy source always. So no argument, I mean, I take in that sense. But it, when it comes to, like, I mean, you know, many other things of, you know, the new development policies or, you know, politics which the society, you know, take in the context of Europe, maybe, you know, we can sit and discuss about it. But in the context of Iran, I actually wanted to use this alembic as an image, which again dates back to kind of a discovery, the power of discoverers of many regions we had. So this image actually represents that, because this was the first water purifier, which was, so then that time they never knew that what kind of transformation it's going to bring in, but they called it safe to light. You know, it was, for me, I mean, it was like kind of a larger visionary statement of that time. So that's, then you see that a society goes into conflict, you know, fighting each other. So I juxtaposed this image with conflict, mainly internal conflict. So I thought, I mean, for me, it was very important to address that.
Your sculptures like Blood Brothers seem to address
this. Yeah, it was in the same
show.
And
these are entirely medieval kind of figures fighting each other. It could be something from...
Yeah. It's taken from an Iraq, I mean, from a Turkish reference.
Do you want to speak to us about Kochi? It's such an important part of your practice, and... how do you combine it with the vision of, say, Muzuris, which is archaeology? You pointed out that Muzuris is the only site which is run by historians rather than, and there is no perhaps direct political intervention in how it is interpreted. And Kochi, with its dynamism, but also its global outreach, and if I may say so, the kind of compromises that also must involve, because that involves engagements with capitalism, that involves engagements with systems which perhaps
I think talk about Kochi, I mean, I would like to kind of make the picture, reassert the idea of excavation there. I mean, I don't know, many people might not be knowing about the excavation which is happening. And where K.N. Panikkar and also the other people who followed that played a big role. The reason is this, because you're excavating with not with an archaeological technical knowledge. You're trying to excavate a place with a great amount of historical understanding, because K.N. Panikkar, somebody who knows the global trade history, you know, he talks about global culture. He's not just an historian, he also talks about archaeology. So he's somebody who's kind of mixed everything together for fine-tuning things and, you know, giving the right answers. So that background is there. So P.J. Cherian actually takes that conversation further. I mean, I've heard him explaining one beautiful structured way of making people understand what happens there. If you dig 1 meter, you cover 1,000 years. If you dig another 1 meter, you go 1,000 years more. That means 2,000 years. Then you dig another 1 meter, you go beyond religions. So it's a very interesting metaphor to kind of start even a biennial project, because that's what we are conflicting about. So that was again there. So I got this, you know, wonderful opportunity in Bombay again. The Bombay becomes, you know, the kind of space of, you know, many actions in our
and
life.
And distance also.
Yeah, so I had met Bose Krishnamachari in 1991, you know, the year I had gone to Bombay, you know, first. So Bose is a very, you know, important figure in this partnership, because we all call him the perennial optimist, you know, because for him, his politics is art. You know, maybe our politics have maybe many other layers, but for him, he believes that art can change, art can bring many changes in the society. So then there is another person who was on the other end of the table, was M.A. Baby, who still carries some signs of P.C. Joshi. You know, if you connect it with, you know, many of our older history started from Bengal and relationship with artists, Ipta
right.
movement and many things. So when I proposed this to do a biennial...
When did you propose it? When was about
it was in
the
2010.
As early as that, huh?
Yeah, 2010. That, you know, then I think the response was very exciting. So Bose, as you know, like, I mean, you know, he's...
Did you know that the site should be Kochi, not no other place
yeah,
in
yeah.
Kerala?
The site was initially decided, it was called Kochi Biennial, and on that table we said, I mean, we do Kochi Biennial. Then it progresses, because Pattanam excavation site is happening. But at the same time, 2006, there was this Musiris Heritage Project happening under the leadership of Benny Kuriakose. It's the time that left was ruling there. So the man who was heading that was the finance minister, the Thomas Isaac. He had a vision that make Musiris as a site for learning history. Our generation should know a better history. So he always kept on emphasizing that. So we met Benny, we met all the ministers. And it's also the time we met Dr. V. Venu, who was
at the National Museum.
Yeah, he was at the National Museum. He was the cultural secretary, the tourism secretary, and also, the culture secretary. And Baby Sir was education minister and also the culture minister. So it was a great teamwork in that table. So I still remember Venu arguing for us, you know, for artists, because he's also a theatre person. He said, most of the time cultural projects fail in the country and it never takes shape because you don't allow cultural audit. You only audit, you only do a financial audit and, you know, blame everything and, you know, then you stop projects. Please allow some space for cultural auditing, you know, that then this project will grow. So post those discussions, like with interest of Thomas Isaac and Benny Kuriakose, we called it Kochi Musiris Biennial, because we increased the depth and scope of the project by titling it.
So also, is there a coupling even in terms of historical knowledge that you want to put out, so which is what you did last time?
No, that was from the beginning itself. So the first edition reflected that, because first edition, when me and Bose decided to do the project, prior to this there is another moment which made many layers of understanding better. We met Amrit Lal, works as a journalist in Indian Express. He's a nephew of the famous poet Ayyappa Panikkar. So we called him. He is very close to us, and we called him to Bombay. Then we sat on making a mission statement for the foundation. Hmm. Amritlal wrote our mission statement in real depth. He taught us many things, you know, so it was almost like a partnership in place growing. So so the first edition of the biennial emphasized on the idea of cosmopolitanism and the multiculturalism. So that's where it all begins.
Tell me, Riaz, this as biennial histories and knowledge around biennials increases, there's been a sort of a division into basically two types of categories of the biennial. So on the one hand, there is the notion of locatedness, and I think Charles Esch and Vasif Kortun in 2005 do this very successfully in Istanbul, where they believe that the city is the subject and the biennial is an instrument of unpacking it. So the structure of the biennial is such that it is almost looked upon almost like a residency project, or whereby the city itself becomes the subject space of the biennial. This is very important. There is a reaction to this very soon, and there are curators like Miwon Kwon, etc., who say that, but what about spontaneity? What about unstructuredness? What about moving away from site? What about dislocation as healthy practices within the biennial? Do you feel that Kochi, by being so located, by being coupled with Buzeres, there is a sort of, you cannot extend yourself very much beyond the kind of historical parameters that you set for yourself? What do you feel about it?
I think Kochi is not conceived as a, not just as a biennial project. You know, though we do, the Kochi Biennial Foundation's mission statement reflects, I don't know, many people must not have read that, but Kochi Muzeres Biennial is one event the Kochi Biennial Foundation does. So, and we focus a lot on education. So, as I explained about what Muzeres contributes into a time, because Kochi has blood relationship with the larger world. That's also one reason like Kochi got immediately accepted. And people consider Kochi as brought in an ecosystem,
right,
in the art context. At the same time, in comparison with other biennials, Kochi is much more experimental in its nature. Kochi is attempting to teach their own audience around, because the people, and especially our commitment, is completely different, because we need to educate people about, because otherwise biennial, any art project looks like you're parachuting something, you know, that the society doesn't understand. We actually started campaigning from 2011 onwards. We brought in people, we started you know, communicating about the context of the biennial, and maybe because of the site specificity of it, the site imaginaries which it proposes, I think it that is the prospect of the biennial, because it brings in a lot of you know, healing tendencies which the time demands, whether it is because Kochi is also a place that you know, the Jewish were never persecuted, you know, so it's also a site, become site in one sense for conflict resolution in that sense. So it's got immediately kind of a larger acceptance. So I would say that Kochi as a site immediately became a people's biennial, because most of the biennials are like distanced from the audience. So Kochi's strength is that the minute is taken by the people, because people felt proud about their own history. So that's where the success of, by putting this energy together, art became the educator of history. Art became the kind of means for making people understanding about conflict. Art is playing a bigger role in a kind of social development. There are a lot of transformations happening in Kochi. Now, recently, like, I mean, you know, we were attending a conference now in Kochi that the collector came to inaugurate it. So he was very proudly saying, because of the biennial, we have decided to kind of bring the smart city to Mattancheri. I don't know what smart cities are all about. I mean, most of the time, like, but if it's an infrastructure development project, and also another initiation which the Info Park has taken, they're bringing technology closer to culture, you know, because the technological development which was happening in Kerala since last 25 years was in, you know, almost like encountering the computer screen, you know, the development happens and, you know, many other legs, but they kept the cultural landscape away from it. So the technocrats never collaborated with creative people in Kerala. So they are coming to now to Fort Kochi Mattanchery to kind of set up partnership projects with technology and art meet. So there are many layers of possibilities to kind of communicate with people.
It must have really stimulated.
Yeah, stimulated many layers.
I'll just ask you one last question and then perhaps we can ask the, our house here. How has the Biennale affected your practice? How does it work for you? Do you go back to your studio and you can work and as if there can be an occlusion of the huge engagements that you have within the biennial?
I think
do you go back to intimate materials like wood and painting and your locality within Borivali and work there?
Yeah, my leaving studio from Bombay, and I shifted twice to Kochi for both the edition. Mm. For the first edition for curating, the second edition because I work as a director of programs. We did a lot of projects like Students Biennale, Students Project, Artist Cinema. So I engage a lot. So the studio is closed. I mean, so, but I would say that what I learned in this last 5 years, it's matchless. I think it's I learned a lot. I understood the art world better. I understood that artists, you know, the best learning is like people demand for it. Because we are developing a new project from that. I'm also working on that. For me also personally, it's a learning process. We're doing a massive project maybe next year. You know, this year we have started the work. It's called Show History. Mm-hmm. So, because this is all started from anecdotes, like when we will, the parents will come with children to see the work and they will not understand it. And the children sometimes ask a lot of questions. I still remember one lady asking me that, can you explain that work to me? Because my son asked and I couldn't answer him. So there's like, you know, you cannot blame them because we have not given them a space because we don't have museums, we don't have cultural institutions which operates, you know, this is an amazing setting. So they don't know the chronology of, you know, the how art does progress. But you ask them about cinema, they will talk. You talk to them about literature, they will talk. But that they don't know how to understand visual art practice. So we are now major project which we are going to involve is that the title which is evolved from the society, Show History, you know, that's going to be our main project. Yeah.
Sounds fantastic. We have about 5 minutes left. I know we're running very tight to time, but anybody have some questions here? Yeah, please, right in front.
So how did you overcome the challenges of cynicism and politics to set up something like the Biennale in Fort Cochin? Because I grew up there and I can, you know, And two, what happens between two biennials? Is that a pause? Is that a full stop? Because like you said, there's nothing like this there. And we've been talking to people like KJ Sohan and others saying, can't there be a Kochi International Center or a Kochi Habitat Center kind of a space? Because all you did was, as you grew up, you went to baptisms and funerals and weddings and, you know, the odd movie. There wasn't much of a cultural context in the 70s and 80s when I was there. So what can it evolve into a much more?
See, that's why I said, I mean, it is not just doing the biennial. It's a 365-day engagement, not only in Fort Cochin. We are also doing projects. But I would say that, I mean, the people of Kochi were the most receptive people for the biennial. The criticism came from, not even from politicians. The criticism even didn't come from the bureaucrats. The criticism came from the same family. You know, the artists were the critics. They thought that, I mean, you know, their, you know, their space is going to go away. So, so we encountered it very well. I mean, because it's a matter of like, I mean, bringing more knowledge into a space. So, the first edition of the biennial, when it happened, the people just, you know, took it as their project. That's one reason we call it People's Biennial. And you know, we came with very interesting campaigns, which was rooted from the space. We started a campaign called My Biennial, It's My Biennial. The second campaign we started was like, It's Our Biennial. Then the third we did, following that was Artist Life Itself. So we kind of countered, you know, in many layers of, Kerala is not just, you know, it's not just cynical. It also resists, you know, things, if they feel, you know, immediately, I mean, whether it is the political things or, I just like to make one point here, I mean, you know, that the Kerala's political system, it's like, it's a very, you know, it's a cycle, I mean, it's an anti-incumbent factor which comes back. So, I still remember M.A. Baby telling a very interesting thing that, I mean, let's take the final decision in Prime Minister's office. So we all came down to remove the political difference first. So we had Jawahar Sarkar, Amitabh Kant, you know, like everybody attending the meeting and okay, the biennial is in Cochin. K.V. Thomas, the MP from there, you know. So it's, we sorted out those things much in advance, and our trust is something to be also like, I mean, you know, thank, because we have a very diverse discipline. Like we have Parmis Taragan, you know, who was the chief of row and very well respected police officer. He's one of trustees. Sunil V, who is the man behind the Incredible India campaign. He made it very big. He lives in Delhi. Then we have Subhash Chandran, who is who's been 36 years. He was the director of programs for NCPA. He handles many culture programs. So our trust is also such that, I mean, people from diverse fields have come together to take it forward. So it is not just me and Bose. I mean, it's a many layered people.
There's a question about gender representation in Kochi, always.
Last year, first year, Dad. Last year, Jitish sorted it out.
Did he? I should ask the women artists in the audience. Any more questions here? Yeah.
I just, Riaz, was thinking that, you know, there's so much to, there's so much similarity between Kochi and Venice as sites and as locations and as cities with this extraordinarily layered history and so on, which is very well, you know, suited to a biennale kind of a project in both cases. But one of the things that I think comes across very strongly in Venice, and more so from year to year, is a sense of decay and a sense of saturation and a sense that the city in itself, even though it continues to host people and art from around the world, is dying and cannot sustain itself under this kind of pressure. Do you have a similar feeling about Kochi Miseris, or do you see a great future for it? Is it more alive, more vital, more dynamic, or is it also, in a sense, likely to collapse under its own weight?
I think this kind of questions were there, I mean, from the beginning. I mean, people, I still remember answering one of the questions which Shudo asked about Kochi being, you know, getting stagnated after a point. So these are some of the decisions which we have taken, unlike many other biennials. You know, I still remember in one of the conferences, I'm, you know, countering that argument, like that stillness created by stagnation is poisonous. I mean, it's taking a reference from one of my Sufi singer friends, Malayalam lying like, I encountered, I mean, that argument. So we have realized, like, most of the time a space gets stagnated because they develop it as a kind of a place that where people come and then just go. So they have become a kind of event management kind of this. But what our responsibility is, like, completely different. We are engaging in projects where we are looking at education as one of the biggest focus. We are doing this Students Biennale project where Vidya is there very much involved. I mean, she's the mentor for all the curators for the Students Biennale, and Fika is involved. So we just, in fact, came back from Kochi. So we are, though we are sitting in Cochin, we are creating a kind of pan-Indian ripple effect in the area of art education. You know, because we want to transform India's art education by making our art students more confident, because most of them study under difficult circumstances. and they have also taken a very strong decision to become artists. So how do you protect that? So you need to show them hope. So we have taken initiatives like that. Then we're doing this artist cinema project. We do a lot of community engagement project in Kochi. We are a 365 day organization. A new project which we are initiating this year, it's again is Kochi becomes like just an idea now, the whole concept. It's called ALT, where we are doing this art project in all the schools, not art schools, all the schools as a first stage in Kerala, where we are designed a project that 4 o'clock to 5:30, they let them free, let them do what they want. We are creating studio spaces inside schools where children after school time, they can do whatever they want, whether they can paint or clay modeling or they can play with things. So that is one structure which we are bringing in. So there'll be a sense of art coming into play. And it will culminate every year in a project called ABC. It's called Art by Children. So every year we are going to do that project. So it's not just the biennial was just a reason, but we have moved on, not making Kochi as a site of saturation. From Kochi's idea, the ideas which we talk about, what even K.N. Panike talks about, the secular ideas, the idea of coexistence, the multiculturalism, the idea of the legacy of cosmopolitanism, that message we want to kind of go, and art should become one of the main reason for that social change, so that we want our next generation at least countering art much more better. Yeah, that's another social engagement project which we are doing, that we have every Wednesday in the government hospital in Ernakulam town, there is a music concert which is conducted by the biennial, and there are two organizations. One is a private hospital funding this music concert in a government hospital, and there is a Mehboob Orchestra, one of the oldest music groups in Fort Kochi. They do this charitable project. We only give them conveyance. Every week they go to the hospital, and all the singers, famous singers, including famous singers, some people are like hobby singers, they want to sing for, but good singers, we don't take anybody, but they'll go and sing for the patients. It's a program. Now it is taking up the Aster Medicity, which is the new biggest hospital. They have taken it up, but they have invited, there is a very interesting group in Kochi, the blind musicians. The Aster Medicity has adopted them. Every day they perform, and they do it every day. So it's interesting, how you, take art into kind of places where people don't relate to, and we took inspiration from the Cleveland Clinic project.
Are we done with questions? Any more? No? So thank you. I can thank Riaz. Thank you, Rizio.